RCB is one of the great clubs, old clubs, and I've seen your work, not personally, but through your website, and you have been doing some phenomenal work. So my compliments to RCB for the great amount of service, great amount of service over a period of last 87 years. It's absolutely mind-boggling community service that you must have done so far. Before I really, and it's a very interesting concept, believe me, avant-garde. And I'll come to that shortly. But before really I start my presentation, I want to take you to a William Mayo's quote. You know, William Mayo, the Mayo brothers, they founded the Mayo Clinic in 1910, almost as old as Rotary. And he says that the aim of medicine is to prevent disease and prolong life. Proper statement. Aim of medicine is to prevent disease and prolong life. However, the ideal of medicine is to eliminate the need of the physician. Now, this, as a doctor, is a profound statement. The ideal of medicine is to prevent the need of a physician. It means that you need to work so hard and so across the scale that disease has to be tackled, disease has to be prevented, and then it really makes a physician redundant. I know it's not possible. So let me concentrate on what is possible. And all these, this presentation is my own presentation and based on my experience. So let me allow to share this presentation with all of you. I hope you're seeing my screen. Are you seeing my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So today I'm going to talk on innovations in healthcare. And while understanding what innovations are, I want you to take to your principle or your theme of today. One is avant-garde. And secondly, your innovation in every field that you have chosen speakers to speak on. So this is, I believe, is very important. And whatever I'm going to present today is something which is not a routine thing that, which is not routine. Avant-garde, as you know, that it's experimental, radical, and unorthodox. Whatever you do, which is experimental, radical, and unorthodox is called as avant-garde. And normally it is with art, normally it is with culture. And if you type avant-garde on Google, what you will see is number of fashion shows and number of newer and newer clothes and dresses there. Health would be an absolutely minor part of that avant-garde. But today I'm going to concentrate on that. And it's important to realize that any innovation of avant-garde, which can be labeled as avant-garde, has to have an aesthetic, has to be aesthetic and has to have an initial unacceptability. Remember this. If you talk about Vivekji's Rahat, I'm sure it was initially unacceptable to have such a large camp, but slowly with his persistence, he could change the tide and he could change. So that is what avant-garde health, and I'm going to talk a little bit on that. So essentially, I believe that any umbrella of social innovations, and we are talking about health, especially in Rotary context, they have to solve social issues. If they are not able to solve social issues, everything else is just theory, not practical. And as Rotarians, we have to realize that it is the practice of impractical, which can be avant-garde, and whether we can reach that level. You know, I have always believed that when you reach the limits of your possibilities, you are into the realms of impossibilities. So initially, whatever is impossible that you feel, when you start working towards it, I'm sure you'll be able to realize that you are actually in the realms of impossibilities. And of course, all innovations have to be efficient. They have to be, they have to have effectiveness. They have to have quality, sustainability, and safety. I'm not talking about affordability on this platform right now, but these are the four or five things which are very crucial for us to realize. So we have two things. A, we have avant-garde, which is something which is unacceptable, something which is unorthodox, but at the same time, it has to have address social issues. And hence, that makes me realize that if I have to define innovation, then I can define it in these terms, that it has to have an invention, of course, something which is new, never been tried in the past, in rotary parlance. It has to have adoption, because unless you adopt it, it doesn't make it practical. And third, it has to have diffusion. Just one camp or one training of teachers should not be there. It has to diffuse in Rotary India or Rotary world. Then that innovation will be accepted. Then that really, to a large extent, we can say that yes, it has come here to stay. And here's these three things to my mind are very crucial. There's another thing which is very important. All innovations have to be usable and desirable. If they are not, it is just theory, it is just cloud. Always we must have our head in the clouds, but we have to make sure that our feet is planted firmly on terra firma. And once we do that, the innovations and practicing innovations is something which is not difficult for us. Have we not addressed polio? So Rotary has a capacity to have this avant-garde innovations. Have we not addressed peace? UNESCO was the first United Nations organization which was founded through efforts of Rotary in 1947. So we have this history. Today, Rotary's work in peace scholarships is something which is phenomenal. It is not valued properly. You can't count it properly. But in spite of that, we have to realize that 1,000 plus peace scholars going into different important decision-making bodies of the world, they are doing phenomenal work. And time will come when we will shake hands with the best in the world to say that peace has been one of the outstanding initiatives of Rotary. So they have to be usable and desirable. But why I'm saying all these things? It doesn't make sense to me to say all these things if Rotary is not able to practice it. Rotary is not able to use it. And hence it's so very crucial for us that whatever I'm going to speak today has to have a Rotary perspective. If Rotary perspective is not there, then I think whatever I'm going to talk is just cloud and nothing else. Just gas, nothing else. Just steam and nothing else. So today I'm going to talk about three or four things. And remember, all these four things I have experienced myself, and that's why I'm putting it forward to you. All these four things were initially considered as unacceptable, initially considered as unorthodox, initially considered as impractical, initially considered as not something which Rotary should put its hand on. But now, after some time, now after so many years, we know that now we can work on this. Let me take you to a sultry evening in 2018. And this was in Fortis Hospital. And this now governor-elect, at that time was the past president, Rajendra Agarwal, he invited me to see a child. The child was Dhanashree Majmule. And this child was admitted in the hospital, waiting for a surgery to be done. She had a heart problem. And this child could not sit. Her cardiac reserve was just 10%. Even a chocolate of a 5-star chocolate for her to finish, she would take 3 hours. She was constantly looking at her father and mother, who she knew that they were crying. She knew that they were crying for her. And she had no idea why, because of her, her parents were crying. She had no idea. Obviously, how she will have? She was just 4 years old at the time. And this 4 or 5 year old child who saw something tremendous, terrible happening with her parents whom she loves, and then nothing is happening to them. You can imagine, put yourself into her mind and you can realize how troublesome it is. Now, what was the case? Case was congenital cardiomyopathy. A cardiomyopathy is the one where heart muscle is so defective that it can't work. Hence, the output was just 10%. Cardiac reserve, output was just 10%. And because this output was 10%, she couldn't walk, she couldn't sit, She couldn't eat properly. Whole thing was real troublesome for her. And she had no idea that why she is having this type of problem when her other age group of children were running around and prancing around and dancing around and eating and whatever they want. So I asked Rajendra Agarwal, why you asked me to see this child? You know, I'm a doctor. And for your information, I started a pediatric heart surgery project during my year in 2012-13. Today, that plant, which we planted in 2012-13, has become a big, big tree. We have so far completed close to 3,000 surgeries, pediatric heart surgeries. All of them over a period of years. And there have been number of global grants. Close to 20 global grants have taken place. All top hospitals in Mumbai, they do pediatric heart surgeries. So 40th was one of them. And I asked him, why you have called me? He said, this child needs heart transplant. Now imagine heart transplant. For us, even as doctors, we will not rely on this surgery at all. We will not rely on this surgery. For Rotary to take this into its hand was something which was not foolish, but astounding. I mean, it was something which none of us could even believe. So I said, what are you talking about? He said, this child needs heart transplant, otherwise this child will not live. The father is a farmer from Jalna. And obviously his per capita income is, the family's per capita income is quite poor. But then he said that Dr. Anvay Mule is the one who is going to do it in 40s, and he has a good name. So I feel that we should try to do it. I said, it's a great idea. Let's work out. The cost, 25 lakhs of this one surgery. So within next few days, we worked up, we located donors, but the donor heart was not there. It was so lucky that within 15 days, one unfortunate child in Aurangabad died of accident. And his father and mother, they were kind enough to donate the heart. In a green corridor, his heart was shifted to Mumbai within 1.5 hours. This child was taken in the operation theater, chest opened, heart removed. Child was on heart-lung machine, bypassing heart altogether. Meanwhile, the heart came. Heart was fitted. And this child received a heart transplant. Extremely emotional moment, let me tell you. Extremely emotional. If this is not avant-garde for Rotary, then I can't imagine what it is. 6 months later, we met this child. It's the felicitation of Rajendra Agarwal as a governor-elect, governor nominee designate. We met this child 6 months later. And this is the child. I couldn't believe my eyes that she was jumping, running. People had to restrain her to do what normal child would do, that she was doing everything and she was more and more enthusiastic. This is the power of thinking beyond what you otherwise would think normal. There is a space. Positively, there is a space where sometimes you have to be mad in your thinking. You have to be over-passionate in your thinking to carry out certain things. We have now done so far 2 more heart transplants in our district, and all 3 of them are successful. And this is what now the next jump from pediatric heart surgery for our district will be this. And I'm putting this to RCB to think on this. All of us have done this number of times. We have given ambulances n number of times, and these ambulances are something which is not new. Everybody for years together we have done. I'm going to stop sharing and take you to a video before I again restart my share. And let me take this to you. Please let me know if you see this. Are you seeing it?
No, we are not seeing it.
You are not seeing
it. You need to go back to screen share.
Okay. I understand. Let me share it and then take it to you. Correct. Now, where is that? Yeah. I think you can see this now.
Yes.
Yes, sir. We can see it. Hello, does it have a sound, sir?
Sir, you have to increase the volume.
Can you hear the sound?
It's very feeble. No. You have to increase the volume.
You're not able to hear the sound?
No, sir. No.
Okay. Doesn't matter. You just have a look and then I will come back to you on this. Okay.
Yes, sir. You can go ahead.
Yeah. I'll just come back, come to the slide, which was before I left, so that now you can hear me, correct?
We will hear, correct.
So this is the normal concept of an ambulance or normal concept of a medical unit. When we go to rural areas, then we have a single unit with us, doctors are there, and we treat in the schools, and whatever has to be done is to be done in the schools or where whichever place is possible. Now, this particular unit is the one which is a different unit. So it is a much more advanced unit compared to a normal medical unit, which we always donate. And this is a unit which, based on your own ideas, you can create any number of rooms inside, any number of extension inside, and for whatever function that you want to be used, that can be used within this this unit. And so this is a very clear advance of whatever is there. Again, something which is initially when we, now I'm a Rotarian since last 25, 26 years. And when we talked about medical unit, we never thought that you could actually create a small hospital here. But here now it is there, and I was involved to some extent in preparation of this or ideating this particular unit. And that's why I'm saying that this is the face of portable medical unit for the future. This is something which is slightly more costly than a normal ambulance, but it's still worth it because you can reach now more number of specialists, more number of places, and much more work can be done in a single unit than otherwise. You know, we always see, and I am an Indian Medical Association past president, so we don't believe in diagnostic medical camps. We believe in therapeutic medical camps. And hence, this particular unit works beautifully with the concept, because I think the use of diagnostic medical camps, if there is no forward management of those diagnoses, then I don't think we should go into that. That is our belief. And this unit beautifully encapsulates the ideal of the proper medical camp. Let me now come down to the third project. Now, all of us, we know you have a blood bank, so you know how it is, and all mothers can be saved. Now, this particular blood bank that we constituted was in Jawhar, which is about 120 kilometers from Mumbai. Patang Shah Kuti Rugnale has having about 3,000 ladies delivering, no blood bank nearby. For blood, you have to go for 3 hours, travel 3 hours, get blood 6 hours, and in the meantime, lot of mothers have died in this hospital. We gave this blood bank, and everything was nice. Every year, about 4,000 odd blood bottles are collected in that village Rugnalay, and then number of mothers are saved. So he'll ask me, what is so avant-garde about it? I said, there's nothing, no avant-garde as far as this is concerned. But what I'm going to show you is slightly different concept. Remember, estimated 300,000 women die annually due to maternal causes. It's a well-known statistic. However, what are these mothers dying from? The truth is, we currently rely on only estimates. We do not have hard facts of why these mothers are dying from. More than half of the world's death, they pass undocumented. And this is a major concern. If we know the reliable cause of death, data is crucial for health planning and prioritization. Most important determinants of maternal deaths, the cause. 88 countries lack complete data. 27 countries have no data. That means over 80% of all births, we do not have any data as to why a mother is dying. And that is an astounding statistics. So in many settings, what we don't know obviously prevents us from reducing maternal mortality. So how do we address it? So first we have to find out what women die from. And the solution starts with political will. More resources so that every country can achieve minimum set of vital data. Pure collection of data itself is a troublesome part for number of countries. And I'm even in India to a large extent, it used to be, now it is much more easier. Tools to reduce maternal mortality and close the data gap. This is what R&D is all about. And this is what we know we need. And hence, better data means better maternal health. Now, why I'm telling this to you? In 2017, I was invited to Rotary Club of Bagada, Lagos, Nigeria. This was a huge grant. Remember, grant was not yet sanctioned. It was a huge grant of $150,000. And this grant had to be screened. You know, large grants in Rotary Foundation, we have a way of tackling this. There is something called as pre-sanction advance visit. So advance visit by a cadre member is important. And since I was a MCH cadre, I was invited to go to Nigeria. I went to Nigeria. And the whole grant of reduction of maternal mortality was only one. Collection of data from all the primary health centers and hospitals. Establishing computers and internets in each and every hospital. Training the doctors as to how to feed the data. Collecting in a single server all the data and then analyzing the data and telling that particular community as to why mothers are dying. This was in 2017. It was estimated, this was in three separate districts. It was estimated that close to 70% reduction of maternal mortality will take place purely because of data collection and analyzing data. What is the advantage of analyzing data? Because most of the probable causes will be pre-identified in the community, and those important patients who are likely to have death can be shifted to the hospital and delivered in the hospital. Nigeria has one of the largest maternal mortality in the world, largest. It is 800. India is about 120. World over, maternal mortality in developed countries is 15, 20, 25 out of 100,000 deliveries. Remember this. 100,000, 1 lakh deliveries, they have 15 or 20 deaths. The other day in United States, a huge outcry that from 15, how the maternal mortality ratio went to 25. So there are a lot of analysis took place out of 100,000. Our Millennium Development Goal for India, and I'm talking about India, which we signed in 2000 to reduce maternal mortality to 25% of the then existing rate, which was 436. So by 2015, we had to reduce it to 109. Unfortunately, it didn't happen except in pockets. But coming back to this, obviously a project of such a nature government has to be involved, health department has to be involved. So they got themselves involved. The server was placed with ministry. They had a pilot project in 2011, which was successful. Germans came together with their data, and German health department came in by donating number of computers and the expertise and the software. Today, this maternal mortality in these three districts has really plummeted. Here you can see me addressing those who are deliverers of these home deliveries, and they call them as a traditional buys or whatever that. And you can see two of them coming together as a two past governors sitting while I'm speaking to them. So this is what a large extent, unusual thought, that purely by data collection you can reduce maternal mortality, and this by identifying causes. And this was something to my mind was simply phenomenal. Let me come down to the fourth one and the last one. This April, from April to May, April to August in 2020, I was one of the assessors of a new programs of scale grant. Now this new program of scale grant is such that Rotary decided to give $2 million to a single grant. Originally, the idea started in 2016 by trustees, but the first program of scale was given to Zambia to malaria prevention. The whole project assisted by PATH, which is a large NGO, and this PATH has an annual turnover about $330 million. Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation Partners International, formerly Rotary and Malaria Partners, they are now renamed like this. It is going to address 10 districts of Zambia, 10 districts, and they are planning to reduce malaria by 90%, and it's a huge reduction of malaria. It was recently awarded, and we hope that this project will come through in future, so that we will have a proper understanding of how large chunks of districts or large chunks of areas can be covered by our projects. Now just imagine three districts of Zambia having less than 90% reduction in malaria. Imagine how many preventable deaths they are going to have. They are going to prevent a number of deaths. And this is what I consider as avant-garde. This is what I consider as something which is beyond our normal thinking. And remember, each and every project here can be done by Rotary Club of Bangalore. So my question to you is, what about you? That I believe that each of these ones can be done by you. You are a club of 87 years standing. You are a club with number of people who are very resourceful. You have resources in government, you have resources in beyond government, you have resources in corporates. I would like to see, for example, for you taking up as heart transplant, at least one project. I would like to see applying for programs of scale grant, $2 million. Only first grant has been awarded this year. There are years in the future. This is something which is unusual. This is something which is beyond a normal thinking for a Rotary. This is something which you and me can really work out at, how to apply for program of scale and create a large, large change in a large population. For example, have you ever thought of doing, now I'm talking about general health, I'm talking about everything else like literacy. Have you ever thought of thinking that one area, one district will be 100% literate? Can we not think of one district 100% cataract free? It's not difficult. My district has taken up this project next year, that we wish to make Palghar district 100% cataract free. There are a number of surgeries which we are planning to do, but everything is in planning stage. But time has come for us to go beyond our normal thought process of projects. I think the more and more we think about projects, we should jettison a normal project. What we should think, can we make an impactful change in the community? Can we have the capacity to create something in the community which will remain for years and years together? You can say yes or you can say no. There's a big difference between a yes and no. And let me end my talk with this beautiful small couplet. It says that in the space between yes and no, there is a lifetime. In the space between yes and no, there is a lifetime. It is the difference between the path you take and the trail you leave behind. It is the difference between the path you take and the trail you leave behind. It is the gap between who you thought you are and who you actually are. It is the gap between who you thought you are and who you actually are. And it is the distinction between the work you do and the legacy you leave behind. This is what huge space, a lifetime between yes and no. Remember, the best and most beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt with heart. This thus said Helen Keller. And when we are looking at impacting large communities, impacting number of beneficiaries, impacting areas around us, we have to think that if we are looking at avant-garde, if we are looking at innovations in healthcare, that is one area where we can actually create citadels, actually create temples of service. Because what is going to remain are these temples. What is going to go is what you and me did to create this temple. But these temples will remain. And I wish you all the best and wish you Godspeed to have multiple temples of service. Thank you so much for inviting me.